Dr. Gavin Artiles. He's currently a professor of pharmacology and toxicology. He's a distinguished university scholar and an associate chair for research in the Department of Pharmacology and Toxicology. He received his bachelor's of science degree from the University of Wisconsin and his PhD from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He did one postdoctoral fellowship at the Institute for Biological Chemistry at the University of Dusseldorf. And then he had an NRSA postdoctoral fellowship at the Bull Center for Alcohol Studies at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. He has served on different committees or on different review panels and study sections, including the Xenobiotic and Nutrient Disposition and Action Committee, the Hepatobiliary Pathophysiology Study Section, and NIAAA, NIDDK, and NIEHS as an ad hoc reviewer. He is or has been a member of multiple editorial boards, such as gastroenterology, alcohol, and hepatobiology, or hepatology. His research has resulted in publication of over 100 journal articles and book chapters, and over 100 abstracts. And Dr. Artiles' research focuses on the interaction between hepatotoxins, such as arsenic, and lifestyle choices, for example, obesity and alcohol, and the initiation of progression of chronic liver diseases. So with that, we're delighted to have him today, and we'll let him present.
Thank you, Jill. And I see Herman's not here, so I guess his baby's been born. So I appreciate the invitation to come here and talk with you guys. I collaborate with Jill and Herman Freebos already, so I'm familiar with the department, and also that there can be a lot of fruitful interactions between bioengineering and medical researchers. And I want to share with you some of the work that I'm doing and we're doing along those lines. So to just get started, I'm going to talk about the natural history of fatty liver diseases. It's actually, regardless if you have liver disease because you're consuming alcohol, because you have hepatitis virus, or because you have type 2 diabetes, which causes also liver disease, they have a similar progression of injury, which is you have steatosis, steatohepatitis. Maybe we could... This one? So it's steatosis, which is this fat accumulation here. There are big fat droplets and little fat droplets. That's macro and microvesicular steatosis. It's actually different kinds of fat. And then you have this focal inflammatory events. That works if people don't fall asleep. I'm going to use this. So you have these focal inflammatory events. Actually, I liked it better before. If that's okay with people. I'm usually lively enough that people don't fall asleep. So you have these focal inflammatory events that is classic for what's called the steatohepatitis phase. Now, this pathology is reversible if the individual removes the underlying HIP. So if the individual stops drinking, loses weight, gets cured from the viral infection, the liver can regenerate and repair itself, and you can get back to normal histology here. However, if the disease progresses and there is no injury, the majority of individuals will eventually develop fibrosis and cirrhosis, and that's the scarring of the organ shown here. And I'm going to move the microphone to the other side. Anyway, so these are basically scar formation and then regenerative nodules. Now, we are pretty good at treating fatty liver disease in that once you get to the end stage liver disease, we are pretty good at treating what's called decompensation. So you don't die from liver disease per se. You die from the sequelae associated with having a failing liver. That's called decompensation. We're pretty good at treating that. We're pretty good at trying to get the individuals to modify their lifestyles, but the relapse rates are very high, both for the obese individuals and the drinkers. The only, quote, cure is for liver transplant. And it is an effective cure, but the transplant waiting list, there are three times as many people on the list as available livers, so this will never be a universal cure for the disease. One thing to emphasize is that there is no proved therapy to halt or reverse disease progression. And that's the goal of my work and goal of many works is by identifying new players in the mechanisms of liver injury, we have an opportunity to maybe do some mechanism-based therapy to prevent or even reverse disease progression. With that background, I want to talk about some of the key events in fatty liver disease so we have an understanding of what we're talking about. One is chronic injury, impaired regeneration, and alterations in the deposition of extracellular matrix, both an increase in deposition and a decrease in the resolution. So first, chronic injury. What we're dealing with here is a basically chronic, we're talking multi-year low-grade inflammatory event driven largely by the innate immune response. And so there is an increase in cell death, predominantly of the hepatocytes, both via two pathways, necrosis and apoptosis. Apoptosis, of course, is programmed cell death, and that can release alarmins to increase the production of an inflammatory response. The cells that die from necrosis, or if they undergo apoptosis and then switch to necrosis, also called necroptosis, they will release even more damps or alarmins that will activate the inflammatory response. Actually, liver disease is a GI tract disease, so the initial hits are coming from the GI tract, and these are pathogen-associated molecular patterns, or PAMs, such as lipopolysaccharide, which induces inflammatory response. And it's not simply you get PAMs and damps and then you get inflammation, you get damage. On top of that, the fatty liver disease itself is enhancing the inflammatory response here, that's called priming, and it's also enhancing the sensitivity of these hepatocytes to injury, and that's called sensitization. Also, there's impaired regeneration, and of course, for the liver, this is a very important phenomenon. The liver is well known to take a hit for the team. Anybody know who this is here? Prometheus, okay? So any time you talk about liver regeneration, you are required by law to show a picture of Prometheus. Now, the reason for this is Prometheus was a titan, and he gave fire to the humans, and the gods punished Prometheus for giving them fire, giving humans fire, by chaining him to a rock, and a vulture or an eagle, depending on which version of mythology you read, came and ate out his liver every day, and it would grow back, and then it would happen again the next day, and that was his chronic punishment. Interesting point there is that even in antiquity, they understood that the liver can regenerate. Now, theologically, that makes sense because the liver's main job is to filter, both biochemically and physically, toxins coming from the GI tract and prevent it from entering systemic blood, what's called the first pass effect when you're talking about pharmacological metabolism. In doing so, it often is exposed to toxic metabolites or primary metabolites that could be toxic, and often takes a hit for the team. So you would much rather have a damaged hepatocyte, especially if it's a DNA-damaged hepatocyte, die and then be repopulated than stick around and be a cancer risk. So this regeneration is a normal process and a restitutive process to the fact that the liver serves as both a biochemical and physical filter. This is a complex coordinated process involving both mitogens, of course cell division, but you also need the ultrastructure and the extracellular matrix to respond dynamically to this stress, and of course you need neoangiogenesis, so you need new blood supplies to feed the new growing organ. And what they have shown with various knockouts and various inhibitors, that failure of any one of these components is sufficient to impair the regenerative process. There are data now suggesting that the individuals who develop chronic liver disease do not actually have more damage per se, but they have genetically an impaired regenerative response to that damage, and that this may actually be driving the chronicity of their disease. Another aspect, again, is the alteration of ECF deposition and resolution, and this is best shown by this scheme here, where normally in a liver you have a balance between the rate of deposition of the matrices and the degradation of these matrices by proteases. However, during fibrosis at end-stage liver disease, you have a much more robust production of extracellular matrix, and the TIMPs that inhibit the matrix metalloproteases that chew up that matrix are much higher too. So you have, again, more deposition and a decrease in resolution of that matrix. And we'll get into that again later when we talk about transitional matrix changes. So based on that background of mechanism, again, the goal of my research is to try to identify new players that are involved in the progression of the disease, see if we can find some druggable targets. So in our laboratory, we have models of steatosis, that fat accumulation. We have models of hepatic inflammation, hepatic fibrosis, and hepatic regeneration to try to model all the aspects of chronic liver disease. And again, talking about hepatic fibrosis a little bit, I want to highlight some points. And this is going back to this scheme here, that another phrase for fibrosis and cirrhosis was called end-stage liver disease. And again, with the assumption that once you get to this stage of the disease, it usually doesn't revert back. And the individual will either die from complications of this disease or they'll get a liver transplant. And the major focus of research when you talk about extracellular matrix changes for hepatologists has focused on end-stage liver disease. to the point that I would call the research to date collagenocentric, because this is mostly a collagen matrix. This is Mason's trichrome stain that stains the collagen fibers blue, and also fibrosocentric. So any time you talk about ECM changes, people automatically assume you're talking about fibrosis and cirrhosis. That totally ignores the fact that the extracellular matrix is a diverse and dynamic compartment of the body. In fact, if you look in fibrosis, there are many more qualitative and quantitative changes to that matrix than just a net increase in collagen 1 alpha 1 production. You have changes in fibronectin, lamin, and you guys can read. The point is that just a collagen matrix is insufficient based on what we understand about the fibrosis. Likewise, the matrix not only responds in a fibrotic situation. Of course, the matrix has many roles. It functions as an adhesive substrate. It provides the ultrastructure that the organ uses to generate its shape. It presents growth factors and retains growth factors. In fact, most of the growth factors that you see in response to an acute phase stress are actually preformed and then are bound to the matrix and then are proteolytically cleaved and released. It also sequesters and stores these growth factors, and of course it serves as a signaling component. So the extracellular matrix will talk to the cells and the cells will talk to the matrix, so you have outside in and inside out communication between the two compartments. And this is poorly understood in the context of liver disease. So our laboratory, and I'll get into the reasons behind it in a minute, but I want to define terms, are very interested in what's called a transitional matrix. Okay, and the best way to describe this is if you cut yourself and you form a scab, that's a matrix change, okay? And that's a transitional matrix. Now, if that wound heals properly, then hopefully your skin's gonna go back to looking normal once it's all completely healed. However, if that wound doesn't heal properly and you get a chronic wound there, you will get a scar. And that's the difference between transitional matrix and fibrotic matrix. So in transitional matrix, you have an acute phase response. You have the complement cascade, the coagulation cascade, acute phase proteins such as PI1, and very specific ECM proteins that accumulate in that matrix. Once the injury is resolved, this matrix goes away and you go back to a healthy matrix. However, if there's chronic injury and this injury is not resolving, then you switch to a more fibrotic phenotype. And that's when the collagen matrices start depositing and you get the fibrosis. And this is less resolvable than this. So we're very interested in knowing what these changes are and how these changes can contribute to the pathology, not only here, but in the progression to fibrosis. Again, because these would be very good druggable targets. And we got onto this bandwagon about 11 years ago or so when we discovered that if we induce an injurious response to the liver, we see a rapid accumulation of what's called fibrin matrices, and this is immunofluorescence for fibrin deposition. And fibrin comes from, of course, the activation of the coagulation cascade to deposit cleaved fibrinogen to fibrin, and then you get that matrix forming. Of course, that's what is formed when you make a scab. On top of that, collagen fibrin matrices are metabolized affected by the induction of plasminogen activator inhibitor 1. And again, here, what is happening is PI1 inhibits urokinase plasminogen activator, tissue plasminogen activator, the main proteases that are involved in resolving this matrix and leading to its degradation. So you can either get fibrin deposition by inducing the coagulation cascade and also by inducing PI1 to block its degradation. And we found in one of our animal models of chronic alcohol exposure that alcohol induces fibrin ECM deposition very robustly in the liver. And this is after 4 weeks of chronic alcohol exposure. And we hypothesize this may well mediate liver damage. And so we started leveraging these questions in our various models. So I want to first talk about some of the models of steatosis that we have. And then coupled with that, of course, is hepatic inflammation. And so this is a chronic model of alcohol exposure in mice. And what you see here is look at the wild type animals exposed to alcohol for 4 weeks. So we see that fat accumulation, and we're starting to see this inflammation and necrosis. We see release of transaminases, such as ALT, which is released by dead and dying hepatocytes. And of course, the pathology scores go up. If we knock out that inhibitor of degradation by one, we see a robust protective effect. And what we found very interesting is we're partially blocking the fat accumulation, but we're completely blocking the inflammation. Okay? And the reason that that's interesting to us is usually these events go hand in hand. If you block the steatosis, you block the inflammation. If you have something that's blocking injury, it usually brings both down. So this suggested very strongly to us that PI1's main effect, and by extension these fibrin matrices, is at the level of inflammation and less at the level of steatosis. So we then pursued that hypothesis further by using a relatively pure model of hepatic inflammation caused by ethanol. And this is what's called a two-hit model. And I alluded to this a little bit already, that one of the things that happens is that the organ is primed and sensitized to a cytotoxic stimulus. So to mimic that, what we did is we gavaged animals for 3 days with doses of ethanol, and then on the fourth day, we injected an inducer of hepatic inflammatory response, lipopolysaccharide. Under normal conditions in naive animals, you see a moderate inflammatory response. You see not much is happening if you look at gross histology, and this is the same for neutrophils, and the neutrophils are pink. You don't really see them very well here. But when we gave ethanol LPS, we saw a robust increase in these necroinflammatory foci, and they're full of neutrophils. And so what we know here then is that we're having a priming and sensitization effect. We then looked at the accumulation of fibrin matrices under these conditions, and you can see that here. Robust accumulation of fiber. The coagulation cascade is indeed activated. We could block this effect by blocking the coagulation cascade with hyrudin, or if we block the induction of PI1 by using the MEK inhibitor UL126, we also blocked fiber accumulation. And both therapies were protective against injury, suggesting both that induction of the coagulation cascade and induction of the inhibition of fibrinolysis were important steps in this process. To make a long story short, we tend to kind of hammer ideas very thoroughly through a number of models. And this is just a laundry list of what we know about fibrin in various models of inflammatory injury. And so what you see here is these are all different models that we've employed. And the check mark means that we've demonstrated that fibrin seems to have a role in inflammation and damage under those conditions. Next, let's talk about hepatic fibrosis. And again, this is the end stage of chronic liver disease. One way to model this is to cause what's called a bile duct ligation. So we surgically ligate the bile duct, and the back pressure of the bile will cause a localized inflammatory response that eventually transitions to a fibrotic response. And you can see that here with the serious red staining, all the red is collagen accumulation. If we knock out PI1 in this bile duct ligation model, we largely block that. And you can see the quantitation here. And hydroxyproline content is a measure of another way to measure collagen deposition. And you can see that's also robustly prevented. Now, one of the dirty little secrets about studying fibrosis in rodent models is rodents are much better than humans at preventing fibrosis, okay? So if you give, for example, a rodent alcohol for the rest of their life, they will never develop fibrosis. And because we know this, what we do a weight of evidence approach. So bile duct ligation is one model we employ, but we also use a model called carbon tetrachloride, which works by a little bit of a different mechanism. It causes basically chronic loss of the hepatocytes, and eventually this causes a fibrotic response to the organ. And by weight of evidence approach, since we don't have a model that completely recapitulates the human fibrotic disease, if you see a positive effect in all the models, that would strongly suggest that this mechanism would therefore be in play in human disease. So we kind of went through this, and so here's a bile duct ligation model. If you look at inflammation, it's very high, cell death is up a little bit, and of course it has relatively robust fibrosis, and we were able to protect with PI1. We invented a new model that is a relatively pure model of fibrosis. This is chronic infusion of suppressor amounts of angiotensin II, which is known to directly activate the fibrotic cells in the liver. And again, no inflammation, no cell death, so it's a relatively pure model. And again, PI1 knockouts will protect under those conditions. And then we started to look at the carbon tet model, and I've already talked a little bit about this. This model is directly, carbon tet directly kills hepatocytes, so there's a very low inflammatory response, very robust cell death, and a very, very strong fibrotic response. In fact, this is a mouse liver after 4 weeks of carbon tetrachloride, and you're getting what's called bridging fibrosis, which is a very severe version of fibrosis. This is basically right before cirrhosis. And when my postdoc did this work, she came into my office and she said, "Dr. Arturo, don't kill me. The pyelon knockouts have more damage." And my response was, "Cool, let's figure that out." So you never know what you're going to get. But so contrary to what we saw in the angiotensin 2 model, and contrary to what we saw in the bile duct ligation model, under these conditions, pyelon knockouts had a much worse liver damage. You can see that very well here with the plasma ALT levels. And you can see that with the fibrosis score. And also the pattern of fibrosis is different, where you have this nice, very straight lines of fibrosis here. It's all over the place in the pyelon knockout, suggesting a very different phenotype. And so we spent a lot of time trying to figure out what is different about the carbon TET model that we get a different phenotype of the pyelon knockouts. And one difference is that the carbon tetrachloride model damages the liver so much that there is a very, very robust regenerative response. And you can see that here by looking at PCNA, which stains cells that are actively cycling. And you can see after carbon tetrachloride, almost 100% of the hepatocytes are PCNA positive. Pi-1 knockouts are much less responsive to that, although they're getting hit worse. And you can see right here, if you look at the different stages of the cell, so in control animals, about 95% of the cells are at rest, and the rest of them are at different stages of the cell cycle. If you look at the wild type animals, only about a third of the cells are at rest, and the rest are at some phase of the cell cycle. In contrast, about the pyelon knockouts, the majority of the cells are still at rest, even though they've been chronically damaged with carbon tetrachloride. Now, what that would translate to is that impaired proliferative response means that the organ cannot regenerate properly from the chronic injury, and therefore is going to switch to that scarring phenotype. And that, so the fibrosis is secondary to this effect. We validated this also with one dose of carbon tetrachloride. And so here what we're doing is looking at the proliferative response after bolus admission. So 12 hours, there's most of the liver's in G0 still, and then it progresses on to different stages of regenerative response. And again, the pyelon knockouts have an impaired entrance into the cell cycle. They eventually do catch up, but that's 72 hours after injury. So the summary of hepatic fibrosis is basically that pyelon does seem to be profibrotic unless you uncover a regenerative response. We then decided to validate that by looking at hepatic regeneration directly. And the way you do this is you can actually surgically resect two-thirds of a mouse liver, and the remaining liver will grow back over the course of about 7 days. And after 7 days, the mouse will have a full-size liver. This is a very robust and very simple model to look at hepatic regeneration. And you can see that here, 48 hours after partial hepatectomy, almost all the hepatocytes are PCNA positive. We do see, again, fibrin deposition transiently under these conditions. If we block the coagulation cascade in these mice, we impair the proliferative response, we impair that fibrin deposition. If we use pyelon knockouts, again, we impair the proliferative response, and we impair fibrin deposition. Not as robustly as blocking the coagulation cascade, but it works. And why? So that these data suggested that messing around with fibrin matrices is a bad thing in the context of hepatic regeneration. And why might that be? Well, we hypothesized, based on what we know about fibrin matrices, that this is a signaling effect between the fibrin matrix and receptors on the cell, the integrins that bind this fibrin matrix. And these are very important for cell-cell communication, of course, cell-to-ECM communication. And the most important one as far as liver regeneration goes that we knew from historically and fibrin are the RGD binding matrices, such as fibrin itself. So we did a study to look to see if we blocked the binding of RGD to the integrin receptor. So basically this outcompetes the extracellular matrix for binding to the receptor. What we see here is we see a similar phenomenon that we saw when we blocked the fibrin matrix accumulation, which is that you impair the proliferative response. And this is showing the cells that are actually in the mitotic phase. And what we're showing here, this is just a different way to show what we showed before. This is the G0. And so after partial hepatectomy, almost all the cells are actively cycling 48 hours after partial hep. And they're at the different stages of the disease. Whereas if you give cyclo-RGD of V, 48 hours later, there's still a significant chunk of the cells that are in G0. So again, we're delaying the proliferative response of the organ. And to make a very long story short, what we found is that, you know, we're hypothesizing that when hepatocytes bind to that fibrin matrix, it serves as one of the ways of Ankerage-dependent growth. And when that matrix is absent, or binding to that matrix is prevented, you have inhibition of Ankerage-dependent growth. And what you see here is IL-6 is a major mitogenic cytokine that's induced under these conditions. But when we block the connection between these, the matrix and the receptors, interferon gamma goes up. And the reason that that's important is interferon gamma blocks the proliferative response to IL-6 signaling. So you have a competitive competition between these two events. And that's mediated via alterations in JAK-STAT signaling. So if STAT1 phosphorylation is up, and you can see that here, then you're going to block the STAT3-induced proliferative response. And in the interest of time, I'm not giving you a lot of depth of this, but so the long story short is that in response to injury, the liver puts down a fibrin matrix. That fibrin matrix is used as a signal to the proliferating cells that it's okay to proliferate, the matrix is ready for you, and then the cells will proliferate. If that matrix is absent or binding to that matrix is prevented, then the cells have an impaired proliferative response. And that's likely why we're seeing the phenotype that we're seeing. Now this suggests, therefore, that PI-1 and by extension fibrin are double-edged swords, that they're both involved in the inflammatory response and the cell death, but also serve in one way or another as a growth mediating factor. That's actually not uncommon, and etiologically makes sense that the injury, the mechanism of your injury, is also the mechanism that stimulates the restitution of that injury. And this is true for tumor necrosis factor alpha, inducible nitric oxide synthase, the TLR ligands such as TLR4, adhesion molecules such as ICAM1, NF-kappa-B, and now we have data with PI-1 and fibrin. And again, suggesting that these are pleiotropic double-edged swords, that they play a role both in the damage and the restitution from that damage. And just to extend a little bit, this may well be what we call the PI-1 paradox. And this is something that's come up in the cancer literature for a long time, which is PI-1 inhibits matrix metabolism. And PI-1, via different mechanisms, should be anti-proliferative. So why, therefore, if you look at cancer, the levels of PI-1 are a negative prognostic indicator for your cancer. What I mean there is if you're diagnosed with like say, lung cancer, and your plasma PI-1 levels are very, very high, more likely you're going to die of metastatic lung cancer. On top of that, there's a gain-of-function polymorphism for PI-1. And if you have that polymorphism, your chances of surviving a cancer are very, very low. And that was called the PI-1 paradox, again, because PI-1 inhibits matrix metabolism, and one of the key components of metastasis, and we'll build on this a little bit later in the talk, is metabolism of the matrix. And so what we may be seeing is, despite the fact that PI-1 is critical for matrix metabolism, it also serves as a signal for regulated growth. And that may well be why there is a PI-1 paradox, that high PI-1 levels are predictive of a metastatic response. So in summary, what we found thus far is that PI-1 and fibrin tend to contribute to chronic liver disease, and we're very excited about these results because there are PI-1 inhibitors that are in clinical trial for especially atherosclerosis. So we could actually potentially repurpose these for treating liver disease. In fact, that some people are actually trying that now in some pilot studies. So PI-1 contributes to hepatic inflammation, at the least at the level of fiber deposition. And I already showed you this, that PI-1 contributes to hepatic fibrosis unless you damage the liver so much that you get a robust proliferative response. If that happens, then PI-1 is responsible also for hepatic proliferation. So again, if you're damaging the liver too much, you actually unmask this proliferative response of PI-1, therefore inhibiting PI-1 would be bad. So building on this, we've hammered a lot on PI-1 and fibrin matrices in the past 10 years. And again, we have all these different models. But that's only one matrix. And one of the issues that we're dealing with in the, you know, switching over to big data and the omics approach is that this is hypothesis driven. We have to hypothesize that fibrin's involved, and then we can test these hypotheses. And what about the other ECM proteins? And more importantly, but what about ECM proteins that nobody knows anything about yet? Can we make new discoveries? And so we started to do what's called ECM proteomics, or looking at what's called the matrisome by doing proteomic approaches. And we're using what's a modification of an approach called the Texas three-step. And this is a sequential extraction of liver tissue until you get this basically a ghost of the liver where you have basically the insoluble matrix. And when you do that, you get different compartments. And the reason that you want to do that, especially with the extracellular matrix, is because we're not simply dealing with the presence or absence of the protein. We're also dealing with the age of the protein. For example, newly formed collagen is a monomer. But if you have fibrosis, that monomer is polymerized and oligomerized to very, very long fibrils. Okay? The solubility of the monomer is very soluble in sodium chloride solution. The oligomer is insoluble and will come out the pellet. And so this is a way to differentiate not only the nature quantitatively of the matrix, but also qualitatively the nature of the matrix. And indeed, when we do that, if we separate out all the proteins that we do by LC-MS via GO annotation being extracellular matrix proteins, you can see we get a nice separation in a normal liver of the different proteins into different compartments. So it's a nice way to kind of separate things out. More importantly, if we look at different responses to stress, so down here is ethanol, if we give lipopolysaccharide to induce an inflammatory response, or if we couple them to do that two-hit effect, you get different responses of the matrix. For example, plasminogen seems to be an acute phase response. Any stress induces it, its presence in basically the pellet fraction. Annexin A1, present with control, disappears with ethanol, disappears with LPS, but if you give both of them, it reappears, but it's in a different compartment. My favorite player, fibrinogen, it's mostly in the less soluble fractions of the matrix and the control, but then it goes all over the map in response to stress. Ethanol has one pattern, LPS has a different pattern, and if you combine them, you get a third pattern. So again, what we're seeing here is a dynamic response of the matrix to stress, not only in what's present, but where, what kind of matrix it is when it's present. And so then we went through each different response and looked at the different extractions. So here's the LPS response. And what we're seeing here with Venn diagrams is everything in the middle is shared between the controls and the LPS treated animals. The left-hand side are proteins that disappeared, and the right-hand side are new proteins that appeared in the different fractions. And to make a net long story short, what we found is this, with one dose of LPS, 24 hours later, we see a net increase in the number of proteins associated with the matrix. And some of these are not surprising, like fibrinogen, which we already knew about, complement C is already known. But we also have some new players that may be of interest, like serpine B5 and clusterin, that may have a contributory role. Likewise, when we looked at ethanol by itself, we are again seeing a net increase in matrix proteins, and again, players that we knew about already, like fibrinogen, but vitronectin is also there. Collagen 5 is very interesting to us, and antithrombin 3 is interesting to us. HMGB2 is a known alarmin to increase with ethanol, so some of these are already validated by what's known. And what's even more interesting is when we look at the Venn diagrams of exclusion of different things to find out their unique proteins. And what I'm talking about here is, we're interested in trying to target ethanol-induced liver disease. So what happens if we give ethanol? Are there any proteins that are unique? And there's only a handful, about 6 or 5. And if we look at the combination where we have this sensitization effect, this two-hit effect, again, we're only dealing with a handful of proteins that are unique to that combination. Okay, that's the beauty of omics approaches, when you can hammer it down to only a handful of candidate genes. And we're not hammering on that and figuring out what they are. Now, these are the qualitative changes to the matrix. So these are new proteins that appear. And you'll also notice that there's the majority of proteins are present in all four fractions. We then looked at these proteins to see if they change quantitatively to the matrix. And this is a very involved figure, and it's called a bubble cluster diagram. So what we have here on the x-axis is the net change in quantitatively in this protein caused by ethanol. And on the y-axis is the net change quantitatively caused by lipopolysaccharide. And the size of the bubble corresponds to the net change when you combine ethanol and LPS. And so what you're looking for here is a disconnect between the combination of the two effects, so where they are here, and the size of the bubble by itself. For example, this guy. This guy is much bigger than would be predicted by the changes caused by the individual thing. So it's a synergistic effect. And what's really interesting to us, and these are the players that are marked that are of interest. So endoplasm, granulins, coated by glycan, hemoperoxin, EMPV. Most of those have been shown in other models to have some sort of modulatory role in inflammation. So those are very interesting to us to chase down further to see if these are in play. And now with CRISPR-Cas9 approaches, it would be relatively very easy to knock down or knock them out. So again, what we're looking at here is hepatic ECM homeostasis and liver disease. And it's much more than just end-stage liver disease, where you have dramatic remodeling and scarring of the liver. And again, this is partially, potentially reversible, but it takes a lot of work. Whereas at earlier stage, you have this transient ECM change that responds dynamically to stress. It is poorly understood and may be a more effective target to prevent blunt the progression of the injury. And so what we know is we need to identify what these proteins are. In our alcohol models, in our non-alcoholic fatty liver disease models, I also have work looking at the interaction between environmental exposure, such as arsenic, and liver disease, and also to determine the impact of these changes. So what they do in our models of inflammation regeneration. Also, one thing that's very interesting to us now is the liver lung axis. And this builds up on some work that we recently published, which is that alcohol not just damages the liver, but also damages the lung. And this is what's called acute lung injury or and acute respiratory distress syndrome. It doesn't cause primary damage to the lung. And what I mean by that is if you look at the lung in someone who's been drinking chronically, you don't see any histological changes. However, if they get pneumonia or viral infection, they're more likely to end up in the ECU with acute respiratory distress syndrome and more likely to die from ARDS than anybody else. And so that's called the alcoholic lung phenotype. And what we're doing here is we are recapitulating that phenotype, and this is when we give etanercept, but that's what a normal lung looks like. And so, but you can see here the alveoli are thickened, and there are these inflammatory foci. And what we found is that when we blocked tumor necrosis factor alpha in the periphery, mostly coming from the liver, we blocked the inflammatory response in the lung. And I'm collaborating with Jill Steinbach on a more elegant way to do this in future using gene targeting approaches. It's very exciting, and I hope that in about 4 or 5 months we'll have more data on that. On top of that, we have recent data, this is by Lauren Poole, one of my graduate students, showing that PI1 under these conditions is also protective. So again, here's the fibrin deposition in a wild type animal after exposed to alcohol and then hit with this acute lung injury. And PI1 knockouts are protected, and we also protect against injury. And you can see that here. Here's control lung, ethanol lung, no histologic differences. If we cause damage, there's a robust increase in the histology versus LPS by itself, and this is prevented in the PI1 knockouts. So we're very, very excited about these data because these data suggest that most of the things that we understand about PI1 in the liver can translate directly over to work with PI1 in the lung. So this is where we are, and one last thing I want to talk about is some collaborative work I'm doing with Herman Fribos to take these matrizome data to try and predict outcome. And what I'm talking about here is that I already alluded to this a little bit, that the extracellular matrix metabolism and the nature of the matrix is known to be a critical component of outcome for cancer. Now, generally speaking, when you have cancer, the primary burden does not kill you. It's metastasis to distal sites that kills you. And if you look at the majority of patients, what they succumb, that is it. And this is, of course, mediated a lot by the extracellular matrix, because the metastasis must seed into the distal sites and also have a soil that allows it to grow once it gets there. And that seed and soil hypothesis has existed for many years. And the ECM is known to critically influence this. And what do changes to the major zone do to this response? And again, this is where if you base on the assumption that most of the phenotype of ECM changes are driven by communication with integrants, there's a lot of principle that this is a good idea. And what you see here in this review is in Trends in Physiological Sciences. These are different integrin inhibitors that have been tried in cancer. And the closer to the bullseye they get, the better, more effective they have been. So thus far, of all these different integrin inhibitors that have tried, have failed at different stages of clinical trials, only about 4 have been successfully employed in the cancer literature. One of the reasons for that may well be because we don't understand, except by Hunt and Peck, what integrins are important and what the phenotype would be. And about this time, a student of mine joined the group named Shanice Hudson, and her interest is in computational biology and cancer. And so I asked her a very simple question: can we take these ECM proteome data and use these to do some computational biology to computationally model what this will do to the integrin phenotype? And so we are at the early stages of that, and we're basically here. So we have our ECM data, we've quantitated it, and we're developing a quantitative model to see if we can use that to predict changes and what these model simulations look like. And I'm not going to do the math here because that's not my forte, but basically what she's modeling with these equations is not only the binding of the matrix to the integrin, but it's a processive process. So once one ECM binds to an integrin, then you're more likely to have another integrin bind to that ECM, and that's called divalent pairing, but also clustering of the ECM, and that all is modeled with these various equations here. And what we've done thus far is take these data and run it through with a response to that has a known phenotype. Okay, we're now talking here about, remember, that carbon tetrachloride model of fibrosis. And the reason we're using this is there is a whole amount of data in the literature identifying which ECMs and which matrix integrins are important in the phenotype for that model. And so what we have here is essentially Lineweaver-Burk binding plots in controls and carbon tetrachloride predicted by using the Michaelis-Menten binding kinetics and the quantity of the matrix in the fractions. And what you see predominantly is a left shift of the binding curves for alpha B beta 3 integrins, alpha 2B beta 3 integrins, two very important ones already known for cancer and already known to have a role, pathophysiologic role, and to be up in the carbon tetrachloride model validated experimentally. So what we've done here is we've trained this computational model using data that we know experimentally to be in play. And we have these data validated enough, now we're ready to go to the next step. We're going to take the data from the ethanol model and see if we can use that to predict which matrices might be driving this phenotype. The next step will then be to adjust the model and simulate to see, okay, let's say we have, it's not just one matrix and how it's binding to this one integrin, but you have a whole bag of matrices and a whole bag of integrins, and they compete with each other, they outcompete each other. So what is going to be the predominant phenotype? So the deterministic model will be, the stochastic model will be next, where we predict, okay, given these matrix changes and given this complement of integrins, what's going to be the integrin phenotype? Okay? And then the last step is we're going to go into a predictive model of cancer and cancer metastasis, saying, and say experimentally in that model, what happens if we take that signal out? Will the metastasis model predict an outcome that is favorable? And with those data, then we can go back to the experiments and then target that ECM interaction and see if that indeed blocks metastasis in this model. And it's a very exciting time and a very fruitful collaboration with people from your department that hopefully will lead to some very interesting work in the future. And with that, I really, again, appreciate the opportunity to present the work that I have. This is a, these are my children. This is a museum in Marseille that I always like present to have as a closing slide when I give this talk because it looks like Matrix to me. I want to thank my lab, Shanice Hudson, Lauren Poole, Christine Dolan, Jamie Young, Anwar Muhammad, and Calvin Yun Ho. Also, former Artelians, I present work by Veronica Massey, some work by Claudia Van Monfort and Lupin Bleu. My collaborators, Michael Merchant, I collaborate heavily with Jesse Roman as a pulmonologist, Guy Brock. He did a lot of the computational work for the ECM proteome. Juliana Baia, of course, Herman Fribos and Jill Steinbach, and some other collaborators I have on other projects that I didn't present today. And with that, thank you for your time, and I'd be happy to take questions.